is the winding path that brought us here. I bless this day distinct amidst darkness. I bless the light, the music laden air, the music laden air. Bless the interweaving of our ways, the lifting of the burdens that we bear. I bless the broken body that we share. Sanctus the heart, sanctus the spirit Christ, sanctus the flesh, in every touch with
good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this service of worship for Advent Sunday. I hope you can all hear me. The audio is working correctly. The lights are on. I'd like to give a very warm welcome to all those watching, especially to Val and to Pat and to Anne, who've said hello in the chat. Hello to you. Glad to have you with us. And also hello to anybody else watching who's watching silently and perhaps meditatively. I've put a link to the service sheet for today into the chat window. It's a very simple worshipping together in Advent service. You can follow it along if you want to click on that link and get it open in another window if you're watching on a laptop, or else just listen along and I'll lead us through the service today. We're going to have a little bit of singing. I've got three Advent hymns or carols for us to sing, and also a prayer at the beginning to light our Advent candle. I don't have an Advent wreath here at home. Those are mostly in our churches, but I do have one purple Advent candle. So I'm going to light that right now to celebrate the first Sunday of our Advent season. And there's a prayer to go along with this first candle, because each of the four candles represents a different aspect or part of the history of our faith. And the first Sunday reminds us of the patriarchs represented by Abraham, our father in faith, and David, the ancestor of the city in which Jesus was born. So let us now pray as we call to mind the God who leads us on. God of Abraham and Sarah, and all the patriarchs of old, you are our Father too. Your love is revealed to us in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of David. Help us in preparing to celebrate his birth, to make our hearts ready for your Holy Spirit, to make his home among us. We ask this through Jesus Christ, the light who is coming into the world. Amen. God in Christ has revealed his glory. Come, let us worship. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the Lord's name is greatly to be praised. Give him praise, you servants of the Lord. O praise the name of the Lord. So now we're going to sing our first hymn together. This one is Lo, He Comes with Clouds Descending. It's a version that was put together last year. You may remember that we did a couple of virtual choir carols last year during Advent. And this is one of them that was led by Mike O'Connor and has several of us singing on it. You won't see our faces on this one, but you will see the words coming up on the screen. So let's sing Lo, He Comes together. Lovely. So now we come to our time of confession, when we reflect on those things that we wish we had not said or done, and those things that we wish we had, and we ask God, our Father, for forgiveness. The words are on the third page of the service booklet, if you're following along. When the Lord comes, he will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Therefore, in the light of Christ, let us confess our sins. Lord our God, in our sin we have avoided your call. Our love for you is like a morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. Have mercy on us, deliver us from judgment, bind up our wounds and revive us. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And may the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins, and assure us of his eternal love in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song will we praise our God. We're now going to listen to our first reading today from the Old Testament. This first reading is taken from the book of the prophet Jeremiah, from chapter 33. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and to the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We're now going to read together Psalm 25. If you're following along, perhaps you'd like to join in with the even verses. Otherwise, listen meditatively to these words. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Let me not be put to shame. Let not my enemies triumph over me. Let none who look to you be put to shame, but let the treacherous be shamed and frustrated. Make me to know your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation, for you have I hoped all the day long. Remember, Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting. Remember not the sins of my youth or my transgressions, but think on me in your goodness, O Lord, according to your steadfast love. Gracious and upright is the Lord, therefore shall he teach sinners in the way. He will guide the humble in doing right and teach his way to the lowly. All the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth to those who keep his covenant and his testimonies. Now, before our gospel reading, we're going to sing together again our second Advent carol hymn.
Come, thou Lord.
Alleluia, Alleluia, prepare the way of the Lord. Make his path straight, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. Alleluia. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to his disciples, there will be signs in the sun, the moon and the stars, and on the earth distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud, with power and great glory. Now, when these things begin to take place, stand up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Then he told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on guard so that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation or drunkenness and the worries of this life, and that day does not catch you unexpectedly, like a trap. For it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole earth. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all these things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. And so may I speak with wisdom in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The season of Advent does strange things to our concept of time. For the church, it is the beginning of a new year, the reversion to the beginning of the story of Jesus Christ, the anticipation of his birth in Bethlehem. But for most people in the West, Advent is the beginning of the end of the year, which won't conclude until Auld Lang Syne. Even more confusing, while in the Christian faith, Advent is a season of looking forward with a longing for a future of justice and righteousness. In secular society, the festive season is more often a time of looking backwards, finding comfort in once upon a time Christmas music, in nostalgia for childhood and family memories. Advent, considered by almost all to be a season of waiting, has a very different feel depending on what it is we're waiting for. Are we waiting for the festival of Jesus, of Christmas, for family time, joy to the world, goodwill to all people, gifts and parties, a celebration of an event from 2021 years ago? Or are we waiting for the reality of God's promise in the words of the prophet Jeremiah? In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. So do we feel that justice and righteousness have already come? Is that our reality as we look around the world today? Or perhaps we feel that with the coming of Jesus and the initial flourishing of the New Testament churches, justice and righteousness did indeed arrive with choirs of angels, but was then lost again in dark ages and reformations, Renaissance and modernism and postmodernism. In Advent, some of us may be looking behind to past glories. Some of us may feel that justice and righteousness have never been stronger. And some of us may feel that we have never truly seen justice and righteousness in our land, and maybe in despair that we shall ever see it. The prophets are used to speaking into this despair and trying to inspire hope. Jerusalem's situation in Jeremiah's day was truly awful. The people of Judah had been violating their covenant with God for centuries. And finally, the threatened punishment comes in the form of the Babylonian Empire, who conquer Jerusalem and carry away all their treasures, the royalty, skilled artisans and educated men, desecrating the temple and tearing the people of God away from their city and from their faith. Their history had been an ever-worsening spiral of wicked, self-serving leaders. If you read the book of Kings, there's never a point where you can truly say, "Ah, here Israel is finally everything it was meant to be." For from the time of King David onwards, justice and righteousness were in decline, playing second fiddle to the pursuit of power and wealth. And even King David himself, though called a man after God's own heart, was still deeply flawed, willing to send another man to his death so David could claim the man's wife for his own. Even today, it is not hard for us to taste the kind of despair that Jeremiah's community must have been experiencing. I recently listened to a podcast discussion between two Christians involved in climate activism and social justice. They were reflecting on their own sense of despair that quite possibly there is nothing at all that anyone can do to save the world from catastrophic climate change. This is what despair really means, that sense that another world, another way forward, has become not only impossible, but even impossible to imagine. From this perspective, many Christians feel the power of Advent far more keenly and far more personally than any other season. Lent demands sorrow from us, but we might not feel necessarily repentant. Easter cries out with joy, but our own lives may not connect with that at all. Pentecost speaks of the fiery new life of the Spirit, when our own hearts may feel dark and cold. But Advent sings most perfectly in tune with the experience of our present age, in our deep longing for a future of justice, mercy, and righteousness, and loving community that we have never truly seen and can barely, if at all, imagine. Advent comprehends perfectly my own state of mind, a constant yearning for a different world that I cannot find the words to describe and have never experienced, but somehow by faith I know it is possible. Maranatha, come Lord Jesus, O come Emmanuel. Not the second coming Lord, but truly the first is needed in our hearts. Again, time plays tricks on us. Jesus has already come and gone and promised to come again. So Advent now is merely a memorial for us, a chance to pretend to be shepherds and magi and enjoy the nativity story through the eyes of children and grandchildren. I'm sure that you can tell that I think Advent is the most adult, present and live of all Christian seasons. Advent is the season that calls us, with the prophet Jeremiah, to imagine a different future, where justice and mercy and righteousness are a present reality in our lives, and not just a pious hope or a nostalgic memory of decades or centuries past, or a mere series of fine words with no tangible meaning. We live in Advent all year round, yearning for something that we have never truly known. We need desperately to engage our imaginations, to try to see exactly what sort of people God is calling us to become. We need to hear the prophet's cry, another world is possible, a world we haven't yet seen, a world for us still to aspire to. Whether we are 15, 50 or 85 years old, whether our energy is spent or we are in the first flush of passionate youth, Advent says, I have a dream, I have a dream today. The stories of Advent are not happy childhood favourites. No star in the east or choir of angels or bucolic stable. The stories of Advent are the deepest, most profound longing from the pits of despair, the ruined cities and divided families where sin and cruelty are Lord, and hope and charity are thin seedlings in the desert. Those currently attempting to cross the English Channel every day are living this reality most keenly, as they seek a land of justice and mercy. But what will they find here if they make it? All the world has a dream of the kingdom of God that Jesus showed us how to build. Advent is our annual reminder that this kingdom is still barely a flickering candle, longing to be a roaring flame. But despair, while understandable, is never heard from the prophet's mouth. As Dr. Martin Luther King cried out, with this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. Even Jeremiah, that most gloomy of prophets, cries out that God's promise cannot be defeated. However you imagine God's promised kingdom of justice, mercy and righteousness, and I hope you do spend this season of Advent imagining it and yearning for it. Its days are surely coming, says the Lord. So now let's declare our faith in God together. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with the power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. So now let's pray together for the coming of the kingdom of God, the kingdom of justice, mercy, and righteousness. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, help us to be aware of your presence with us now at all times. Not just 2,000 years ago or in the hope of the second coming, but to be aware of you in this room with us. We are bathing in your love. Make us aware of your presence at the very heart of our being, so that we may not fall into despair. That the sort of community and society we long for that we fear it may not be possible, help us to know that it is possible that it is within our hearts even now. Help us to long for that to be made manifest through the power of your Spirit, to know that although in our own strength these things are impossible, with you all things are possible. Lord, help us to imagine a different sort of world in which your righteousness and justice are ever present. Where our default position is love for each other, forgiveness, understanding. Help us to see this coming, to notice signs of it emerging, to reach out and encourage its growth. To nurture it with our own efforts, but always to know that it is yours, God, to make the growth happen. Help us to wait patiently, but with joy in our hearts, knowing what is truly coming. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we remember all those we love and care for, our families and friends, those we know who are sick. And we speak their names aloud or in our hearts, lifting them up to the Lord and asking for his blessing and for his healing and for his peace. We say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen. And so now, before our final blessing, we're going to sing together one final Advent carol. This one is O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. And you may remember that around this time last year, we did a virtual choir with 18 of us, I believe, singing along to this carol. So we're going to enjoy listening and singing along with that again now. O come, Emmanuel.
Thank you.
Hope you enjoyed that trip down memory lane from last year, seeing all of last year's hairstyles once again. So now our final Advent Sunday blessing. Christ, the Son of Righteousness, shine upon you. Scatter the darkness before your path and make you ready to meet him when he comes in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you and all those you love and care for, this day and always. Amen. Go in peace, to love and to serve the Lord, in the name of Christ. Amen. Farewell for now. Happy Advent.
As the winding path that brought us here, I bless this day distinct amidst our days. I bless the light, the music later now, the music later. Sanctus the heart, Sanctus the spirit.